A very good evening to all the PhD scholars. And in this session, we are going to talk about how to identify academic writing. So we are referring to Lise Hamp Lyons and Ben Heasley's book published by Cambridge University Press. And it is about study writing, a course in writing skills for academic purpose. So with the help of that, we are trying to identify some characteristics, some tangible characteristics which can help us in identifying it. Let me share my slides with everybody, and you also will have to do one or two small activities in between. So keep on watching the slides and identifying some of the characteristics. Okay, so we have two small parts. This is part one, and then we will also complete the second part of study writing skills today. So academic writing processes, when we see, our aim in this study is to introduce the idea that writing is a set of process. So when we think of academic writing, we have to also keep in mind that academic writing is a set of process. General writing, as against academic writing, we use the word non-academic writing, or we can say writing for general purpose. Now, in that, in all those kinds of writings, perhaps we may not follow a set of process, like we don't move step by step. Sometimes our first writing itself is the final writing in non-academic writing. But in academic writing, it is never going to be that our first writing is the final writing. So we need to think of a set of processes. Showing how to distinguish between academic and personal styles of writing, then we'll try to see what are the linguistic markers or what are our choices of the words when we write for academic purpose and for personal writings. Looking at the grammar of academic discourse, we'll try to see whether we can easily identify the grammar of academic discourse, and practicing visualizing text as a pre-writing step. So how do we visualize a text? That is a pre-writing step, because several drafts are necessary to be written as an academic writing process. Well, let us see. So thinking about writing processes, first, when you write an important text, do you make more than one draft, or it is the only draft there? Well, fine. We are not going to do an activity where you give the answers to everything, but we can imagine that the question here is supposed to tell us that we are not supposed to make one the first draft as the final draft. That is how the question is put here. If option is given, do you prefer to write on paper or use computer? Have you ever asked yourself even why? So again, these are the habits of mind. The question itself is trying to give an answer that whether you love to write on paper or on computer, these are mere habits of mind. And when you are doing academic writing in today's time, that is in 21st century, and people normally use smartphones wherein you may be noting down something in terms of either a photograph of something useful to you for your research work, or maybe jotting down some notes. If you have a stylus, then with the stylus you may be writing, or very quickly using your thumbs to type down several things on your mobile device or bookmarking websites on the go. So as we imagine that research is a kind of an activity that it keeps on happening on the go, whatever we are doing, but at the back of the mind, there is always something pertaining to our research work that is ongoing. So we keep on making some mental folders in our memory, or some kinds of those virtual folders in laptop or in mobile device. Or if we have some kind of diary with us constantly, if we keep diary, then in diary also we keep on jotting down the things. As we still come from a very traditional mindset where when we were growing, writing was still the only thing. So our habits of minds still have not completely changed, though we use technology a lot to note down or jot down everything in digital form. So we still have to keep or maintain some kind of a book or physical form of our lecture notes or what we are planning to do, what discussions we are going to do. So that still goes in the physical form. So maybe with you also, you may prefer to write on a paper or whatever, but then all these are the habits of mind. But you will have to now. Now it is time that if I have a diary, it is good I use diary. If I have a mobile phone, then I should be ready to use mobile phone. If I have a laptop, then laptop also. Or a cloud kind of a thing where in drive, you are using something. So over the digital devices, you can use those material anywhere, in any form, in print form also, or in mobile device also, or in laptop also, or somebody else's borrowed device also, you can quickly use on that also. The why answer is always, as we say, it is just habit of mind. We need to change our habit of mind to see that we can have a mastery over maximum available tools for our various forms of documentation, jotting down of points, not taking or writing the things on the go. Yeah. Well, third point is, what do you what do you do before you start writing? Yeah? The question aims to say that, are you planning anything? Are you jotting down bulleted points and then writing or not? Nowadays, we have started telling our students, our MS students also, that you can use a rough page in your answer book. When you write your university exam, use last page as a rough page. And there you write bulleted points, that how are you going to develop your answer. And that will help you in writing your answer in a much organized way. When you were students, we are not telling this, but this is that point, that before you start writing anything for academic purpose, you have to jot down some points, you have to organize the beginning, the middle, the end, and something shuffling will happen there. Fourth point, how do you start writing? Do you begin at the beginning or jump in wherever you have some ideas? Do you think one approach is better than the another one? Well, in digital writing, you are aware, these are all set of processes for academic writing. So in digital writing, we are aware that we can start writing anywhere, and then we can easily go up and start writing a line above or a line below or line in between also. That is the advantage of digital writing, which obviously is not the advantage when we are handwriting the thing, because maybe there is no space above or below, or then we have to make an arrow. We have to make an arrow, and then we have to say that now page number so and so, that paragraph will be inserted here in the final draft. So that is what we do in a print paper. But digital writing is good. So whenever you get an idea and we think that this idea will fix here, so we can move on cursor above or below and quickly start doing that. So with digital habits of writing, we can start from anywhere. We can start from anywhere, and then we can keep on reshuffling our paragraphs and other things. Even in our final drafts of PhDs, when we were writing, like much earlier, before, though I started using laptop when I was drafting my PhD chapters, final chapters, but initially I was not having a laptop. So you used to write down several things, and then all those pages you will go to the supervisor, and then supervisor may suggest that this you bring in here, here you bring something else, those things, and then again you sit down to rewrite everything. And so in a more another sequence, so what actually was happening, that there was lots of wastage of time in rewriting the same thing also. Maybe there was an advantage of that also, that you are thinking a little bit deeper when you are doing rewriting, because writing is a slow process. And sometimes you feel that slowness is necessary to go a little bit deeper. And suddenly you may strike some idea when you are slowly thinking about something. In digital things, when things happen very fast, the speed is at the cost of death, as Baudrillard has observed, that the speed that we have in digital time is at the cost of death. So that is one of the disadvantages. Many times we see that when we do things with digital, it happens very fast, but it may happen at the cost of death also. Well, but these are the differences, but these are all set of processes, that where we begin and how we move on different ideas. Fifth point, what do you do while you are writing? Do you stop and think? Do you ever go back to the beginning and start again? A very important and necessary step in set of processes for academic writing. So time and again, we have to rethink. We have to stop and think. And again, we have to go at the beginning to change something. As in the literature review activity we have done, that though we will start with the beginning, but introduction is always written at the end. That is what we have to follow in thesis writing also. Though you will start with introduction, you will write introduction and you will move towards conclusion, but you have to always remember that maybe at the beginning or end of all the chapters, you may have to go back to the beginning, that is your introduction, and keep on making some changes in the introduction, because you don't know how your thesis is going to grow in subsequent chapters. So the kind of a shape it is taking, you have to give the molding to the beginning. The molding should be given again to the beginning in a similar way also. But this is to be practiced in all kinds of writing. Even if you're writing a research paper, then also you have to practice this, or whatever kinds of other things you are writing, let it be even personal writing, but just see that what is the set of process. Do you need to go back again to somewhere? Well, you are practicing academic writing, even in your personal writings. Though normally now we don't think that anybody might be writing any personal things in detail, like letters are almost bygone things. So we do communicate, but our communications is short sentences now. How are you? I want this, you want this, and WhatsApp chat or the thing. But these are very short sentences. You don't think that if you sit down to write a letter, because it happens normally 15 days after, 1 month after, or 3 months after. So you have a lot many things to share with your parents, with your friends. So the letters normally get lengthy because you're not doing it every day, every moment. Well, today the digital tools, we do things at every moment. Whenever you remember anybody, you can quickly ping in. So the detailed writing habit or thinking habit also is dying because of this. So I don't know whether you are ever doing any personal writing where these kinds of habits might be required, except for you are maintaining your own personal diary. And if you are making an entry in the diary, and if those diary entries are a bit longer, then maybe you may be thinking of this. But as you know, the diaries are diaries, they are personal things. So we don't care where we started. We don't care to go and again change the beginning sentence. That normally we don't do in our personal diary writing also. Well, but as a part of set of processes for academic writing, these are something that if we keep on practicing, then we can slowly and steadily master those skills also. So finally, when you finish your first complete draft, what do you do next? Obviously, we have to reread the draft. The entire draft is to be reread again. And each and every rereading of our draft will tell us that something that was in my mind has not come here in form of words. So I still need to look for better words, better sentence structures, that what actually is in my mind must be coming on the piece of paper. One of the best thing, but many times students are asking this question when they make presentations in our MA department. So when we comment that your presentation is haphazard, what you actually want to say is still not coming even after all the slides that you have shown. So they say that, but what should we do when we face such a problem? So one of the ideas that I used to give them is that keep your PPT ready overnight, because if you want to make it on Monday, then Sunday night before you go to sleep, keep it ready and shut down and you go to sleep. Early in the morning, after 6-7 years or hours of your sleep, again now open the PPT and see. Now you require a kind of a cooling down or going away from that topic for a while. For a while you forget that topic, cool down, and then revisit with a fresh mind. And then you try to see as a reader that somebody is listening to you, and this is the slides. Are they getting everything you wanted to say? Suddenly you will strike that, well, here I need to add something, here I need to remove something, and you will get that. But that cooling down time is very, very important. So even when you are preparing your drafts of various chapters or thesis and other thing, then what next is cool down for a while. And after some days, after a few days, revisit your write-up, your chapter, and try to see as a reader, if somebody is reading, you are not a writer, but you are a reader now. Are all those ideas reaching down to that third person that can be something that can be visualized here? So in this six steps, and this six steps, we say that how to think about set of processes that is necessary for academic writing. A very quick recap. Yeah? When you write an important text, do you make more than one draft? Well, we say yes, necessarily we require to do that. If option is given, do you prefer paper or computer? Whatever it is, we have to train our mind to be ready for those kinds of things. And on the move, on the go, we have to keep on thinking and jotting down whatever important points we find anywhere for our research work. What do you do before you start writing, planning, jotting down bulleted points or making a trajectory, like a Freytag's triangle of tragedy, tragedy triangle? So you make, this is where I begin, this will be my rising action, here there will be a climax, and here I will go down, and this is how the ending will happen. So I visualize my text in bulleted points. How do you start writing? Beginning, well, if I'm doing digital writing, I can start anywhere and then I can easily move on. If I'm using a diary or a paper, loose papers will always help me because I can shuffle the loose papers quickly. I can put down the point, page number, and I can keep on editing the page numbers and put on different words also in that capacity. Fifth one, what do you do while you are writing? Stopping, stop and think, necessarily going back again to a previous paragraph. That is the habit of the mind to be developed. And finally, after completing one draft, rereading, after cooling down time for 6 to 8 hours or a day or two, and then rereading the draft as a reader to find the gaps if there are anywhere in between. Yeah. Well, now let us come to this point here. And remember, this is an activity, but as we are in a virtual mode, we are not doing that activity right now. Those students, when they were here in physical mode, we were asking them that whatever questions, answers you have in your mind, discuss with your friends and see that what can be the outcome of this. So, objective of this activity was to capture thinking about something in order to talk clearly about it later on. That was the kind of an activity that we have done. But as we are in virtual mode, we are not doing the activity. Yes, so coming down to define academic writing, to find after looking at the set of processes, if you have to define academic writing and see characteristics of this writing. So when we think of academic writing, we find that there are different kinds of academic writing in English, because this depends upon what is your purpose, what is your purpose, for which academic purpose you are doing this. Some of these differences arise from the different disciplines and the ways in which they create and share knowledge. Some relate to the audience, that is reader, and some to the use of which the text will be put. So we have to keep lot many things in mind. What is our discipline? Like even in your case, one of you is doing on literature, the another two on ELT, for example, means teaching of language in different dynamics. So even your academic writing, your vocabulary will be much different. Your process of research will also be different, and your academic writing will also be different. A reader who is going to read your work, that is obviously very important. In your case, obviously, it will be some professors who are going to read your research work. So you always keep some academician in the mind as an audience. You are not writing your thesis for a layman. So that level you can maintain in that. That can give you a little bit high level of academic writing in this. What will be the use of this text? Your text is obviously for the thesis evaluation. It is going to give you a degree. That is the best thing that you can right now think of. Later on, if you are planning to convert your thesis into a book, then some changes you may require. You have to edit that book because it is now going to for a larger audience, wherein the students of undergrads or postgrads might also be reading your books. Or any other policymakers might be reading your thesis. In case of Komal and Megha's work, if some policymakers are thinking about those things, then how are they going to approach? That are their use of text will be different there. So looking at all this thing, academic writing keeps on changing. Its definition, characteristics, nature keeps on changing accordingly. The rules and definitions are also equally complicated in that term. And we also will see that many people say that you should write in this way. Many people do not agree with that idea also. That we will face when we will do small activity here. Yet we can easily recognize the difference between informal and formal writing. So, well, what are those differences? How can we differentiate between informal and formal, that is academic writing? Well, let us try to recognize academic writing through some examples. I think the examples only will be the best form to help us in this. Well, let us read this sentence and try to identify three features that we can think are academic, from this sentence. Now, first you will see that this five long lines itself is academic writing. Yeah? The first, you can also think in that way, that the another informal writing will have a shorter sentences. As soon as you see very complex and long sentence, that is, it seems to be a very formal writing, a kind of an academic writing that we see. So that itself is manifested that if this is one sentence, then the length of the sentence itself tells that. And then you see two, three, I think there are four commas in one sentence. So that is another punctuation mark that will tell us that this is still the feature of the academic writing. Very long, complex sentence, punctuation marks, comma, colon a lot, and lesser full stops or lesser periods, and more of comma, semicolon, colon are used in academic writing. So it says something like this: linguists were and remain convinced by Noam Chomsky of the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, who discovered that however disparate human languages seem, all share a common basic structure seemingly hardwired into the brain. Well, this again, if you have to tell what is the meaning of the sentence, you will have to again go to the beginning of the sentence and read in bits and pieces, and then you will perhaps understand that what you want to say. So linguists are convinced that the structure of the language is hardwired in the brain. So that is what Noam Chomsky, with the help of other people, tries to say, that the structure of the language is hardwired in human brain. And that is why it is easy for the children to acquire the language, the first language there. But see the complexity of writing that makes it very academic. And when you read this, when you read this sentence, the way you speak says a lot about you, for example. The way you speak says a lot about you. Now you see here that the way you speak, now it means that what is that way of speaking is not defined. It is not defined here. It is more generalized, the way you speak. But you can say, what is that way of speaking? Is it fast? Is it slow? Is it humorous? Is it somber? Is it very low? It is very high pitch. What is that? So that is vague. There is vagueness in this sentence. In the very beginning, the way you speak is not defined very clearly there. It says a lot about you. A lot means what? What does it tell about somebody who is a speaker of this there? So identify three features of this sentence that are non-academic to you. Again, it is an activity to be done in a class with the physical partners. But well, we are not doing that in a virtual gathering here. And let us see the answers. The first write-up in features of academic one. In the first sentence, complex sentence, serious subject, reference to academics like linguists and Noam Chomsky of Massachusetts Institute. Use of passive voice, linguist were and remain convinced by, and shows truth status of statement or stance of writer who says seemingly hardwired in the brain. So again, very quickly, complex we have seen earlier, the sentence, subject obviously is very serious. It is not something trivial topic that they are talking about there, like the other one was about somebody speaking, and you are talking about the character of the person, which is a trivial topic because you can never know about person's character by how the people are talking about them. So it's more a trivial subject. academic references you make always when you are writing academically. The so and so person told this, and so you are telling something. So academic discourse is rarely without the reference to some other academicians. So time and again, you say that, well, when I speak about, for example, postmodernism, so I will bring 2-3 postmodernists, their ideas I'll put, and then I said that, well, in a given context by what these people are saying, it seems that postmodernism is this or it is that. Now, if you have a problem with those observations, you will have a problem with my observation also, because my stance is based on what I am telling about the postmodernist critic. So reference to other academician is a necessary component for academic writing. Passive voice, normally, now here there is a problem, passive or active. So now many people say that, well, active sentences are good enough. So this argument is losing its battle, again, in academic writing. Old school people still prefer to use passive sentences in academic writing because it gives a kind of an objectivity. When I use active sentence, then it seems to be like I am emotionally connected with what I am saying. And that is considered as a limitation of a research work, where objectivity is to be maintained between the knower and the non also. So passive voice is still practiced, but many are now opposing, and they seem to say that active voice can be used if people are able to maintain that objectivity even with the active voice. And finally, this word seemingly, see the linguistic marker, seemingly. So even with the reference of academicians and other things, you are still not saying with certainty, but it seems to be. Because whether language is really hardwired in our mind or not is nearly impossible to identify. We can assume that, because the question is that how do people learn language and why animals don't learn language? What is there in the difference as a mind between the animal and the human being who also is an animal? There must be something, which we are still looking for. That language is acquired by the children within 2-3 years. So if there is nothing in the mind, then how this all language will start finding its structure, and they start uttering the things in a particular structure. Even if you're teaching a foreign language to a grown-up person, if you go by structural method, and then you keep on ramming some sentence structures again and again in the mind of the student, their minds will start accepting those structures, and they will start thinking and speaking in the similar way. So many linguists say that, well, the structure is hardwired in the mind, or maybe we have evolved in a different way than animals. Our mind over the years, since the time, like thousands of years back, when we started learning language, our mind or our DNA composition started changing, and they started making some gaps in our mind in such a way that structurally we have started acquiring language. Maybe that is an evolution of a human brain as separate to the animal brain, we can see so. But with all those things, there are lots of gaps in between. And because there are gaps, you will say your stance as a writer or truth status. What is the truth status? Because you can't see it clearly and show it to other people, this hardwired language in the mind, you say seemingly hardwired in the brain. That is very important feature of academic writing also. Reference to academician and stance is very important point, apart from complex sentence, because now you can go for simple sentence instead of complex sentence. Serious subject, obviously it will be serious, so there's no problem, but complexity of sentence, people may start writing in simple sentence, not much problem. Passive to active, not much problem. But these two points, reference to academician and the truth status, that is very, very important to be maintained in academic writing. Now, in the same context, we see the second sentence, vague vocabulary such as way, say, a lot, lack of precision, we find here. Directly addressing the reader as you, conversational style, which is again becoming a formal style, non-formal style, not a formal style. And it is a simple sentence structure also. So this is, I think, makes something very clear in our mind, what is formal and non-formal, or how we see the formal language as an academic writing also. Now there is some activity for you. These are some features. Okay, let us see what the summary of what we have discussed so far, and then one activity is coming here. So if you want to organize the things, what we have studied so far in identifying the characteristics of academic writing, then we say that there are six important aspects like reader, content, style, organization, grammar, and vocabulary. These are six important parts which we see. And then in academic and non-academic, how they keep on changing. Reader, academic is academicians, and then family and friends. Okay? Content, serious thought, conversational one. Okay? Style, complex sentences showing considerable variety in construction, mostly simple for non-academic, compound sentences, joint conjunction, and but might be there. Okay? Organization, clear and well-planned one, because set of processes, various drafts, thinking about writing will help in a clear and well-planned organization. Non-academic, less likely to be as clear and organized one. Okay? Grammar, likely to be error-free. For English students, it must be error-free, obviously. And in non-academic, may not always use complete sentence also. Okay? Vocabulary, technical academic language used accurately in terms of vocabulary. Particular words are to be used, whereas short forms, idioms, slangs can also be used in non-academic writing. But we can't use idioms or slangs in our write-up. Idioms perhaps may strike in your mind in a different way, that what's problem with the idiom. So when you're doing literary study or using literary language in a literary way, a metaphorical way, to be more precise, then idioms will add a value to your language. So if it is a literary study, an idiomatic use of language will be welcomed, because the language teachers will understand, the academician who are in the language will understand the idiomatic expression of your words. But when it comes to science or other disciplines, then perhaps they may lose the idiomatic interpretation. So generally, when we say academic writing should avoid the use of idioms and other things also, but no problem. So far as the English language students are doing that, for the academicians who are also of English language, they can easily grab the meaning behind the idiomatic expression also. But well, reader, content, style, organization, grammar, vocabulary, and this is how we can decide between the levels of formality in academic and non-academic writing. And here is a small activity here. So there are a few sentences, you have to just think and keep something in your mind, whether that sentence is academic or non-academic. A stands for academic and N stands for non-academic. And what is your reason behind that? Why do you consider a particular sentence academic or non-academic? Can you quickly do this activity? Very quickly, can you have a look at it and note down, this is A because of this reason, this is N because of the other reason. The reasons should come from what we have discussed earlier. From there, if you can grab the reasons and you can tell that. The screen is here for a few more minutes. Yeah. Yes, screen is here for, have a look at the sentences and try to identify the academic or non-academic feature in that. And if possible, keep one of the reasons also in your mind, that why is that sentence academic or non-academic. just a few minutes and then a quick reading. Yes, Nimesh, do you want to say anything?
Yes, sir. First sentence is non-academic writing. There is a clear mention of I, and in academic writing, I and such words shouldn't be mentioned.
Okay, yes, yeah. Yes, fine. So you can say this, no? That use of I or a short form couldn't, that is a short form, that also makes it non-academic. Could not should be written fully. Yeah. Yes, good. So that is how you are supposed to identify the academic and non-academic. Yeah. Anybody else would like to add to this? Yes.
In the first sentence, I add one more point that his tone of the sentence is informal. So that is why I can say it is a not academic sentence writing.
Yeah, okay, fine. Yes, you can add that also. Okay, second sentence. What do you say about second sentence?
So it's academic writing because there is a reference of date. June 2008 is given.
Okay.
And it's
there is use of passing voice. Use of precise vocabulary, initial.
Even some words are used like analyzed. Completed. So
yes.
Passive and vocabulary.
Yes. Something is analyzed, completed, that also is the vocabulary, which will be more formal one. Okay.
And another thing, sir, we can add is, it is about academic one, like test, taken and analyzed.
So serious subject
is more academic.
Yes, serious subject seems to be reflected in the work also. Yeah. Okay, fine. So now let us see this slide. Okay. Let me change the slide. Yes, so we see here this that how we look at this idea. So then the third sentence was having again using I, your, short form I would or I had. That is why then the reason for the fourth sentence in an academic work, we would expect some bibliographic references after some researchers. So when we make a sentence that some researchers, but somewhere in parentheses, we have to add who, at least one or two you have to mention when you say some researchers. So, and then they are cited also in text as well as at the end of the text also. So this is how we define that these are the academic features and the non-academic features in writing. So this will perhaps make the thing very clear that what do we mean or how do we identify academic and non-academic writing in simple sentences there, first thing. So even in your coursework, if there is a question, then also you will be able to identify and write a kind of a long answer regarding with example on academic and non-academic writing. Still, the second part of the topic is to identify paragraphs. I have already sent one email to you, to three of you, Komal, Pujaba and Mega. I have sent an email. In email, you might have seen four paragraphs. Have you got the email? Yes. So that is what we have to see now. Okay. So keep those emails handy and let me share a few slides to discuss that paragraphs. Okay, I'm sharing my slides here to see. You keep your four paragraphs very handy. Very quickly, I will show on the slides also here those paragraphs, but you won't be able to read all the four paragraphs thoroughly. So start having one an overview of all the four paragraphs. So read this paragraph. Huh? So we have this, you have to distinguish between levels of formality among this paragraph, and we have to give reasons that how to what level these paragraphs are more academic than the another one. This is more academic than the another one. So let us now go one step further into identifying the academic quality of rather all academic writings. So this is paragraph A, small one, 4.5 lines of paragraph. Then second paragraph, paragraphs are already sent to all of you in an email. This is the second paragraph, a rather longer one. Again, it is an academic writing only, but we want to see the level of formality or academic writing among four academic paragraphs. Okay, third one is this one, which has a kind of a citation, also a URL is given there for some hyperlink reference that is given there, a web and other things. And the last one is this, quite a very long one with in-text citations. You find there in-text citation, Kuni 1994, Hakin 1991, these are those in-text citations. Okay, so these are the four paragraphs. Yes, first one, second one, B, C, and D. We identify them by A, B, C, D. So when we now try to look at these paragraphs, like which is more academic and what are the reasons that it is more academic there? Well, let us come to our answers, that what makes one more academic than the another one. Yeah? After reading these paragraphs, we have to give the ratings according to 1 to 4, to the most academic, to the least academic paragraph. And then if you are physically present, we can ask that now talk among yourself and discuss among yourself that what according to you and why a particular paragraph is academic or non-academic one. So from the most to the least academic, how do we see these paragraphs in different capacities? Now B, for example, B is the most academic, having been taken from a research book on academic writing. It exhibits complex sentence structure with distant verb forms such as present perfect, have, had, example, high level vocabulary such as reciprocal relationship and complex cognitive and linguistic skills, content that display the outcome of serious thought, and nominalization also. Nominalization means this is something that is frequently used by academic writers, that is the noun forms of verbs to help focus their work on concepts rather than specific action. So using development, application, activation rather than develop, active, or apply. So more of nominalization is done by more of academic writers. So serious thought, nominalization, a high level of grammar displayed in the writing, exhibits complex sentence. So B is considered comparatively among the four as the most academic writing, academic language here. Then comes the second one is D. This is the second most academic, being taken from a research report. It exhibits complex sentence, references, academic vocabulary, effective capability, and disseminated. Passives are there, it has been claimed, and discourse markers, like with this in mind, that is discourse markers, the capability to and to prepare our students for this endeavor. This text is more explicit than B. It belongs academic genre. It is a kind of a research report also. Then C. This is a mixture of academic and non-academic modes. It contains direct reference to the reader, your and you, but it also contains a passive. The reader is focused, and it is itself a long complex sentence. The text was taken from an instructional manual here. And A is considered as the least in this group. This could be part of speech or an informal letter or an email. The style is didactic rather than academic. The use of a question and answer sequence suggests informality, as does the use of the filler anyway also in this write-up. So I think this activity, in this activity, in C and A, you might not have much of a problem that, okay, fine, the arguments are good enough to justify that they are lesser academic. But you may have a problem in B and D, because they seem, or sometimes to many students, B seems to be more academic than B also. Because in our other activities, we have seen that many of them have found that D, because of in-text citations and other things, seems to be more academic than the B one also. The only defense that can be given about B as more academic is that its language is more academic. The citation is not a part of, it's a part of academic writing, but not of a language. So when you are seriously concentrating on the writing only, then citation is technicality. Citation becomes a part of technicality. So you have to concentrate more on vocabulary, sentence structure formation, and how these nominalizations and other things are used more effectively also. This point is very important, which is in D, which also is a linguistic part, and that is discourse markers. Discourse markers, which also adds value to the academic writing. So discourse markers, how they are very effectively used. And when you are doing a research for literature, at that time, lots of interpretations are required. And then discourse markers play a very vital role, which obviously speaks about the stance that we are taking. And in literary interpretation, it will be always very difficult to say that this is this and that is that. Very clearly, it is very difficult to interpret anything and make a kind of a final judgment, because literature is never ending thing and any final judgments are nearly impossible. At that time, such discourse markers will obviously play a very vital role in the writing of such theses also. Okay, so then finally, let us try to visualize in the writing process, in the set of writing processes, the final and very important point is visualizing the text. So in the first part, we have put 6 questions to see what is the set of processes. As a second part, we have tried to differentiate between the academic and non-academic writing and some of the features of academic writing. We have tried to identify with difference from other the non-academic and other academic writing. And in the final part, we are trying to see that how can we visualize our text as a part of writing process. So before we study grammar and linguistic relativity of academic writing, let us see how can we visualize our text. To write texts that are academic, begin by thinking about 3 key elements, and that is audience, purpose, and material. And we can do that by asking 3 questions, like who is the text for? Let us call it A. And why is the text needed? Why is the text needed? Who is the text for? That is audience. Yeah? Why is the text needed? That is the purpose, P for purpose. And what resources, data, evidence, referencing material, and so on, have I got that I can use? That is my material. So with this, we can start drafting or visualizing that how my text is going to look. You can think of this when you plan to write a research paper, and then you can see in the beginning that, well, this is what I want to do. These are the things I have. This are the articles I have with me, and I'm going to use these articles, and I'm going to write for a particular purpose. So that is audience, my purpose, means what I want to prove through my art write-up, and what material I have with me. Material, it is very important to make sure you have enough material, resources, data, evidence, etc. available. So even when we sit down to write for a research paper, that is very important to be seen. And in case of many of the research articles, later on we realize that, well, we are not able to find enough resources or material. We thought we have enough, but then as we move on, we start finding that enough data and other things are still not available. And then to move on becomes very, very difficult also. So this is one of the initial phase that people always find when they take a very offbeat topic in for a research, a very offbeat topic, like sometimes very challenging topic are taken for research, and then they have to fumble around a lot in completing their research. Also, one of the reason is that they have not visualized their material properly. They fail to visualize, and obviously it happens when people take on any topic for the research also. But well, now as you already have started moving on this path, now whatever you have and the topic that you have selected, even if you face a crisis of material, you have to work out, you have to find and work on the things also. One of the ideas that now UGC is recommending that coursework should be done before the PhD begins or before the topic is finalized. It should be done before. So if before everything is discussed, then the candidates may still get some ideas about what are the things that they have to keep in mind, which after 2 years or at the end of the research, they may face as a problem. And one of the reason is this also. Many of our candidates who have registered are not able to complete their research. And the reason is this material only. They thought that I will find everything, but now things are not available. One student is doing on journalistic writing and he wants to look for Gandhi's journalism. And now he thought that there are these journals, these things are there. But now he's finding very difficult to go to this. And now he says we'll reduce the topic. So how many things are you going to omit now? And how many times are you going to change your topic if you're not finding the material enough? And then it's sometimes it happens that the thesis is like a mere research paper. It is not like a thesis, but it seems to be like you are writing for a seminar a paper also. So materials is very important a point. Then when we sit down to write about this drafting things, at that time, what ideas, evidence, arguments, how do we highlight those things is necessary as a part of our visualization. Mind mapping thing is necessary. So on a rough draft, we try to jot down rough ideas at different places. And then we give a proper a shape of those things also. Some of the things which, these are some of the things which are very helpful to me when I sit down to think of some presentations which I have to make at some places for. For example, when somebody invites me to speak on some topic, then I will just start making some circles and some ideas that what will be the movement of those things that I have to do in that presentation. So then what material I have, what will be my trajectory that you have to jot down in various ways in your rough draft. And then you keep on shuffling. This is all before you make your PPT on the final night, which we call it Katal Ki Raat, which you might have experienced in your presentation season. In your presentation season, you might have experienced Katal Ki Raat, where final PPT is prepared. But before that, lots of thing goes into jotting down the ideas in different capacities also. So how those ideas, evidence, arguments are being presented or being shared, that we think of when we visualize our text. Let me come down to that slide and share it again with all of you. So material, then how we highlight our ideas, evidence and arguments and jotting down at various places. This is all about visualizing that what I plan to present. And this happens even before it is a final research paper or your final PPT in terms of simple presentation of things. Purpose, is it a report or an argument and going to be used for what? So most of your thesis is an argument. You are making an argument and trying to prove some of the arguments that you have made as a hypothesis. So yours is not a report. You are, if like Komal Megha, they are working for finishing school or language teaching. It can be a part of a report later on, but right now you are making some arguments about how things are working or not working and how things can work in a better way. So right now we take thesis as an argument. So your purpose is very clear in that dynamics. And audience, as we have seen earlier also, that here your readers are academicians. So you are writing for another academicians who are supposed to read your this work also. So this is how we see academic writing and visualizing our text or academic writing as a set of process. It's a set of process. And we think of writing on a paper to a digital form of writing. That all becomes a part of our set of processes and ultimately to visualize our text that we see when we think of the academic writing there. If you have any questions pertaining to this in your mind, anybody, then you can ask if you have any doubt or question regarding this.